So I have here the latest and greatest 14 and 16 inch MacBook Pro and also the Mac Mini, all equipped with the M2 Pro chipset inside. But what M2 Pro chipset is the fastest in each of these three Macs? Now, other YouTubers out there will be comparing, say, the M2 Max to the M1 Max, and then also other ones will be comparing, say, the M2 Pro to the thin M2 Pro to the thin M1, and then also like the M1 Pro, and so on and so forth. But I want to do something a little bit different today. What I want to do is I want to do a review comparison for you by putting the same chipset in all three of the new Macs that have just come out and see if there's a difference in performance and speed amongst the three models if they all have that exact same chip. Now, there is only one chipset that is available in all three of these Macs that I have, and that is the M2 Pro Normal. Now, you're probably wondering what I mean by the M2 Pro Normal. Well, this is the standard 12-core CPU with 4 efficiency cores and 8 performance cores, and either the choice of 16 or 19 cores GPU, then a choice of 16 or 32 gigabytes of RAM. So for the purpose of today's experiment, I have brought Macs with the exact same chipset inside them, and this is the 12-core CPU, the 19-core CPU, and also 16 gigabytes of RAM in each of these Macs, and also I've chosen 512 gigabytes of storage too. I do also have a binned M2 Pro, so this is the one with the 10 cores inside it, the 4 efficiency cores, and also the 6 performance cores, and then also having that 16 core GPU. And I'll be comparing this to the brand new M2 Pro with the 12 core variant that I've just spoke about. But that'll be a little bit further on into the video. But as mentioned, the main purpose is to see if we will get a difference between the 14 and 16 inch MacBook Pros and the Mac Mini in performance using the identical specs inside them. Well, you know what the experiment's going to be, so let's get started. Well, after doing a quick unboxing that I'm not going to go into lots of details, as it's basically the same as the last MacBook Pros and the same Mac Minis for donkeys, and I'm sure loads more YouTubers out there will be making videos about some fancy stickers inside that you get and all of that kind of stuff. However, I have set up all three MacBooks on my review bench here, and I've plugged in a portable monitor into the Mac Mini with a wireless keyboard and mouse. So, by popular demand, the first test I'm going to do is a good old benchmark test, and that's going to be a Geekbench 5 test. So all three Macs have this installed, and first of all, let's look at the single core performance. So on the single core benchmark, you can see on Geekbench 5, really, when we have the M2 chipsets, all of the single cores are basically the same speed across the whole of the M2 family. So right at the bottom, you can see we've got the M2 Air, what comes in at a score of 1,909, and the M2 Pro at 1,965, 1,972, then 1,980. Yes, there's very, very slight sort of improvement, but over the M1 Pro, what you can see here, this was the 10 core one, you could see that definitely there has been an improvement in single core sort of performance that we're getting now with the M2 instead. It was really, really impressive. So next, let's move on to what multi-score gave us. So for multi-core performance with the M2 Pro chipsets, you can see there really isn't anything in it. The same chipset inside all of the three of these same Macs, we're getting scores that are so similar to each other. For example, the Mac Mini, then we've got the 14-inch MacBook Pro, then the 16-inch MacBook Pro at the top. But then at the bottom, you can see the difference there with the M1 Pro, and then after that, you've also got the M2 Air as well, the standard M2 chipset. But overall, the three devices that we have here right now, the speeds for multi-core are basically exactly the same. Basically, probably about 1% in it between all of the scores here, which is really nothing at all. And while we're here in Geekbench, let's finally do a metal score in Geekbench 5. So Geekbench 5 also does a compute metal speed, so this is basically testing out metal, the graphics power, and you can see here with the M2 Pro Mac Mini all the way up to the 16-inch MacBook Pro, Again, there's really nothing in it. They're very, very similar indeed. You can definitely see there's improvements over the M1 Pro 10 core version and also over the 10 core M2 normal chipset too. Remember that M1 Pro, the reason why it's pulling out in front is it does have more performance cores inside it. So that is why we're seeing the leaps and bounds. Plus also we get some more graphical cores in the M1 Pro 2 compared to the normal M2 chipset. Okay, moving on from Geekbench 5, let's now move on to Cinebench R23. And first of all, let's look at the single core performance in here. So starting out then with the single core, as you can see here, really for the M2 Pro in all three of these devices, they're all basically the same. We're getting very, very similar scores indeed. What is also impressive is also that the M2 normal is actually slightly behind here on the Cinebench single core, but really it is still way ahead than the M1 Pro in comparison, for example. And now let's do multi-core performance. So again, just like the Geekbench, the multi-core score for Cinebench is very, very similar sort of picture we've got here. All three of the M2 Pro Max that we have here are basically neck and neck within just a few points of each other. If I rerun these tests again, really you'd get the same sort of score. And just in case you wanted to know, I did rerun the Geekbench score, and sometimes, like for example, the 14-inch MacBook Pro leapt ahead. But generally speaking, this was the order that things came in their sort of speed sort of score for multi-core on Geekbench and also for Cinebench that you can see right here. Okay, I think stopping here on standard CPU and GPU benchmarks is a good place to stop right now, to be fair. I think we're getting the picture here for standard benchmark tools. All three of these Macs essentially perform the same within less than 1% of performance with each of them. I could do more tests, for example, say in Blender, we're doing some rendering there, or I could do, for example, Eugene Heaven, for example, doing a graphical sort of benchmark there. But I think you get the idea. All the scores are going to be around about the same, so really there isn't that much point. But before we continue on with doing any more tests, let's narrow down that 1% of sort of difference between them. Like I said, it's less than 1% difference between these three Macs. And let's have a look here. So basically, I would say in third place is the Mac Mini. And then after that, we've got the 14-inch MacBook Pro. Then after that, we've got the 16-inch MacBook Pro, all having this M2 Pro chipset inside it. So the Mac Mini's last, and then the 16-inch MacBook Pro is first. But like I will say again, it's within 1% sort of difference between them all together in that 1%. What's absolutely crazy to be when you think about it. But moving on, let's move on to something a little bit more real now. Let's do something that was quite common that we'd actually do with these Macs. So I'm actually going to do an export in Final Cut Pro now. I've actually got a video, what is 11 minutes long, and I'm going to export this. And let's see what the difference is then between these three Macs. So then, we're doing an 11 minute video, Final Cut Pro Export 4K H.365. You can see here the differences that we have. And to be honest, straight away, the M2 MacBook Air obviously was the slowest. Then it was the M1 Pro as expected. But as you can see here, for the M2 chipsets in all three of these Macs, there's literally about 3 seconds between it. If we rerun this test again, like I did do that, actually what actually happened was the 14-inch MacBook Pro came out in front this time. But the other two devices, again, were about 1 second behind. But generally speaking, I did do the test one more time again, and it did come out the same results here, where you can actually see the 16-inch MacBook Pro actually did it ever so slightly faster. With giving us this performance with these Macs, and like what you saw there with the normal M2 and things like this, one of the main changes was that with the M2 sort of MacBook Air and the MacBook Pro, what we did get on the smallest amount of, say, storage is that we actually got slower speeds. And I want to know if we're going to get slower speeds if we pick 512 gigabytes on each of these three Macs. So I'm going to do a Blackmagic test now of the hard drives and see how fast they spin up to on their write speed. So we're doing the Blackmagic benchmarking here for the actual storage to see kind of what write speeds we were getting. You can see here that the M2 Air was the slowest, as we know, because I think Apple sort of cheated out with cheaper chipsets inside them to make the SSD a little bit slower this time round. But then the M1 Pro obviously was way ahead than that M2 Air. But then, interesting, the M2 Pro inside the Mac Mini was actually slower than what you actually get in the 14 and the 16-inch MacBook Pros. To be honest though, what I would say is, even with getting a write speed of 3,481 megabytes, really that is still very fast. And for an M2 Pro chipset, really you're not gonna be bottlenecking yourself in having a sort of slower speed here. The chipsets can only sort of throw out footage or rendering, whatever it's trying to do, as fast as it can. And obviously it needs to write that speed as quick as it can too. And to be honest, 3,481 sort of megabytes is more than enough for actual sort of writing sort of speeds. But obviously still, the 14 inch and the 16 inch MacBook Pros have far faster storage in it. And maybe the main compensation for that is because you can choose to have the M2 Max chipsets inside there. So for thermal heat temperatures, this is also in degrees centigrade. That's the sort of thing that we use here in the UK. I redid that 4K sort of video that I exported earlier that I showed you guys, the H365. And basically where it got to the last sort of 30 sort of seconds, I did do sort of testing of the heat of where everything was. So starting right at the bottom, obviously the M2 MacBook Air was really, really high. It was 56 degrees. But then if you look above them, things aren't really that different. We actually had the M1 Pro, it was 38 degrees. The M2 Pro and the Mac Mini, 39. Then the M2 Pro and the 14 inch, that was 40 degrees. And then the 16 inch MacBook Pro was also 39 degrees too. So really, there wasn't that much in it with the actual sort of heat, as it were, amongst really the last sort of year of MacBook Pros with the 14 and 16 inch with that M1 Pro to this generation here. They're all around about the same sort of heat. But obviously, yeah, the M2 Air was 56 degrees, mainly because there is no fan inside it. Well, there we have it, guys. As you can see here, with all the most sort of benchmark scores that we've just done there and all that testing, you can see there is less than 1% difference between each of the Macs. Remember, that's not 1% per se between the Mac Mini and the 14 inch MacBook Pro, and then another 1% to the 16 inch MacBook Pro. I'm talking about all three together. There's only 1% difference in that, but the performance is all together. So what I'm trying to say here is, if you were to pick yourself a brand new Mac based on just literally performance alone, and you've got the same chipset, and you're wanting to get that certain M2 Pro chipset inside one of these three Macs, there isn't really gonna be any difference. Where things will be different is to do with, say, portability, actually having a screen, for example, on the go with a MacBook Pro. Also those ports as well, and also other things like battery life and all of those bits and pieces that you have to consider too. But the main thing, for just genuine standard performance, it's exactly the same across three models. But obviously, you guys are not going to be satisfied with that. You'll definitely want to know then, what is the difference then between these Macs that I brought? What was the end result? Well, the end result that I can conclude is this, is that the Mac Mini did come last, and then it was followed by the 14 inch and 16 inch MacBook Pro in the performance. So the 16 inch MacBook Pro gave us that extra tiny bit more performance, even though it's like a blink of an eye difference if you exported, say, a video that was, say, 30 minutes long, for example. But you're probably wondering why this is the case. And the main reasons that I think behind this is that when we got the 14 inch and the 16 inch MacBook Pros in 2021, you've got to remember, we've got brand new designs there, we've got brand new fans, and a brand new way of cooling everything down. Now, with the 14 inch, we got a brilliant new design, but the 16 inch design was basically a slightly larger version than the 14 inch. So that basically meant like the heat pipe rail was slightly longer. There's also a little bit more space of air to blow around in the 16 inch. And that's why I think it slightly beats out the 14 inch, but this is just my own opinion. But then you're probably wondering about the, say, the Mac Mini. The Mac Mini, at the end of the day, is the most chunkiest out of all of these. Even with the lids closed on the 14 and 16 inch MacBook Pros, the Mac Pro is still thicker, so you'd think there's even more room and space inside that. Well, I think the reason why this came last is mainly because the Mac Mini design has been out for 12 years, and the cooling design inside hasn't really changed at all over those years. There isn't a way to sort of suck in air really efficiently and blow it out again, and that's why I think basically it's done it. And the reason why Apple haven't actually updated the design is because they know this. There's no point updating the design, because basically it's within less than 1% to, say, the 16 inch MacBook Pro. So you know the old saying, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. So I think this is why they have left it the way it is right now. But what about the M2 Pro bin cord version versus the M2 Pro normal version? Well, I've just done a Geekbench for this, so let's have a look at that. So comparing the two Mac Minis that we have here, obviously the single core score, nothing really was gonna happen So starting out here then with the Geekbench 5 for the single core for these two Mac Minis, as you can see here, as expected, they're basically neck and neck for single core. But moving over to multi-core score, then yes, the 10 core CPU and the 16 core. But then for multi-core score with the 12 core and the 19 core CPU, you can see it's way ahead than the 10 core and the 16 core. There is definitely a difference there. So yeah, do choose wisely on the sort of multi-core sort of performance that you do want to pick for on the M2 Pro. But having said that though, remember that the M2 Pro, what you see here, what is the 10 core and the 16 core version, remember this is far faster than what we got with the last year binned M1 Pro chipset. So just like last time with the M1 Pro binned version of cores versus the normal M1 Pro with all the cores inside it, there is a little bit of difference there. But at the end of the day, you've got to spec up the machine to the right sort of needs for you. So if you are just doing basic video editing and things like this, the normal binned version M2 Pro probably be absolutely fine. If you start chucking in like loads of 4K sort of clips and videos and things like this, yeah, you're probably actually gonna need a more sort of higher up M2 Pro with those extra cores and maybe GPU cores. But overall, as you can see, there is a little bit more of a difference again, but not that much. So if you do want to get yourself a great bargain out there, definitely still consider getting yourself the brand new Mac Mini with the M2 Pro inside it. But in either case, guys, I think we've got the answer here to our original question. And that is there any difference if you pick the exact same chipset amongst all the different Macs out there, the new ones that have just come out? And the answer is no, unless there's like about a 1% difference in it and they're all within that 1%. So really, there's nothing in it at all. What are your thoughts on this, guys? Do you think it doesn't matter what kind of Mac you pick on performance, or do you think it does matter that you need to pick basically the right core for the right kind of sort of cores and chipset and bits and pieces for your Mac? I would love to know, so put it down in the comments below. And also on that note, guys, it's also time to wrap up this video. So if you have enjoyed watching it, please do press the like button. And also, if you want to hear the latest Apple news, reviews, and comparisons like this one, please also make sure you subscribe to the channel and hit that notification bell. Until next time, guys, I will see you really soon. Take care. Bye-bye.